us now begin in Isaiah chapter 22. Chapter 22 is entitled The Burden of Jerusalem. This again is a prophecy in regards to the impending Assyrian invasion of Jerusalem. This begin with prophecy 16:33, verse 1, the burden of the Valley of Vision. Now the Valley of Vision refers to Jerusalem. The reason it's called this is because this and many other prophecies came by visions seen in the valley near and inside the city. So, many visions were seen in the valleys of Jerusalem. And verses 1 through 5 pretty much describes the impending siege. The invading armies outside the walls of Jerusalem, and those who are trying to escape are eventually caught and slaughtered. Then we move down to verse 6. It says, and Elam bare the quiver with chariots of men and horsemen, and Kerr uncovered the shield. Elam and Kerr referred to Media and Persia. At this point in history, the Medians and the Persians were aligned with the Assyrians. They would later break free from the Assyrians and eventually take down Babylon. But at this point in history, they are allied with the Assyrians, so that's prophecy 16:34. 16:35 is in verse 7, and it shall come to pass that thy choicest valleys shall be full of chariots, and the horsemen shall set themselves in array at the gate. So Isaiah is saying there will be men and chariots and horses in the valleys. And from the way it's described, it looks like the valleys are going to be filled with men and chariots. Okay. Prophecy 16:36, verses 8 through 11. This foretells King Hezekiah's vain attempts to fortify the city. He'll do things such as conserve the water supply, to examine the walls of Jerusalem to see if there are any cracks, and he'll even tear down houses to fortify the walls. But Jeremiah says these precautions will not save him in the end, and it did not. Jerusalem was only saved once Hezekiah actually cried out to God for help. This all takes place in Isaiah chapters 36 through 37. I didn't mention that earlier. Then, verses 12 and 14 is prophecy 16:37. Isaiah foretells what the attitude of the people inside the city walls is going to be. God is expecting them to cry out to him in repentance, wear sackcloth and ashes, and instead, they are just feasting and drinking wine. In verse 13, it says, let us eat and drink, for tomorrow we shall die. I'm sure you all have heard that line before. Well, that's where it comes from. And verse 14 says that, according to the Lord, surely this iniquity shall not be purged from you till ye die, saith the Lord God of hosts. And now we move to verses 15 through 19. This is prophecy 16:38. This is a prophecy in regards to Shebna, treasurer of the palace. Shebna had become quite haughty. He had actually built a very fancy tomb for himself high up on a rock. And that disgusted the Lord greatly. So Isaiah prophesies that he shall not be buried in this fancy tomb. Instead, he shall be taken. He shall be taken captive, and he shall die as a stranger in a strange land. And then we move to verses 20 through 22. This is prophecy 16:39. Here, Isaiah prophesies Shebna's replacement, Eliakim, and. Verses 21 says, I will clothe him with thy robe and strengthen him with my girdle, and I will commit thy government into his hand. So he's going to wear royal robes, and the responsibility of the government will be upon him. In verse 22, and the key of the house of David will I lay upon his shoulder. So he shall open, and none shall shut, and he shall shut, and none shall open. So... Eliakim, the replacement of Shebna, is going to did become someone of great authority. I believe he had more authority than even Shebna did in his office. Then we have verse 23. This is prophecy 16:40, and I will fasten him as a nail in a sure place, and for a glorious throne to his father's house. And they shall hang upon him all the glory of his father's house, the offspring, the issue, all vessels of small quantity, from the vessels of cups, even to all the vessels of the flagons. Now, what this is referring to, these nails, is that it was custom to build certain pegs into a house to hang things on. These were not small, tiny nails, which you can just pull out with a hammer. These were very large pegs that when they were hammered into the wall, they were meant to stay there permanently. So the God is saying that Eliakim will be a permanent peg, and upon him will hang honor. And not only honor will be on him, but as well as his offspring, and all of his vessels as well. That's again prophecy 16:40. Then verse 25 is prophecy 16:41, where he talks about Shebna, goes back to Shebna, and Isaiah says, the nail that is fastened in the sure place shall be removed and cut down and fall, and the burden was upon it shall be cut off. So Shebna will be cut off. Everything he had prior to his being taken captive is going to be removed, and it's going to be removed by God himself. All right, chapter 23. This is the judgment that will fall upon the city of Tyre. This was a highly commercial city and seaport. There are those who say that Tyre is also symbolic of end times Babylon in Revelation. That city was also, it will be, a great city of merchandise and trade and wealth. And the fall of Tyre is symbolic of the coming fall of the great Babylon. Anyway, all right, let's read verse 1. The burden of Tyre, howl ye ships of Tarshish, for it is laid waste, so that there is no house, no entering in. So, prophecy 16:42, Tyre will be completely destroyed, completely demolished, and then... And then it also says, no entering in from the land of Chittim, it is revealed to them. Now, Chittim is the Isle of Cyprus, and they will report that the seaport has also been demolished, destroyed, or filled in, and no ships can enter it. So, The city will be destroyed. There'll be nothing to access by land, and as will the seaport, so that no ships will enter. Those are prophecies 1642 and 1643. Now we come down to verse 4. It says, "Be thou ashamed, O Zidon." Zidon was the kingdom that created Tyre. It's been called, they're called the mother of Tyre. And it says in verse 4, "For the sea hath spoken, even the strength of the sea, saying, I travail not, nor bring forth children, neither do I nourish up young men, nor bring up virgins." Zidon, that means Zidon will be so weakened by the destruction of Tyre, it will not be able to create a brand new city. That's what it's talking about. It says, neither do I nourish up, don't bring forth children, or nourish up young men, or bring up virgins. It's going to be pretty much rendered sterile, you know, by the fall of Tyre. And then that's prophecy 1644. And then 1645 says, "As a report concerning Egypt, so shall they be sorely pained at the report of Tyre." This will also, the fall of Tyre would also be devastating to Egypt, because much of what was produced in Egypt was taken into Tyre, and that's where it was sold off. Tyre is based upon the Nile River, which of course runs through Egypt. So Tyre, very very accessible commercial city for Egypt. And when Tyre falls, Egypt will have no place to send their goods, and they will be, their economy will be crippled because of that. That's 1645. Okay, 1646, verses 6 through 11. This passage talks about how some of the inhabitants of Tyre will flee in ships to Tarshish. Tarshish, by the way, is Spain, just so you know. "They shall flee away in ships to Tarshish, and they took a lot of the wealth with them. And so when Nebuchadnezzar," I forgot to mention, the city of Tyre would fall to Nebuchadnezzar. Yes, it wasn't just Jerusalem and Judah that fell to Nebuchadnezzar. Nebuchadnezzar was under a great in the process of a great siege of many other cities and nations, and Tyre was one of them. And when the Babylonian armies arrived at Tyre and saw that so much of the wealth had been taken out, they were incensed and gave them all the motivation they needed to completely demolish the city, because there was nothing worth saving there as far as they were concerned. Again, that's verse 6. Prophecy 1646. Alright. Verse 12. It says, "And he said, Thou shalt no more rejoice, O thou oppressed virgin, daughter of Zidon. Arise, pass over to Chittim. There also shall have no rest." So, the inhabitants of Tyre will never ever find joy again, nor will they find rest. And it says, "Pass over to Chittim." That means even should they escape to the Isle of Cyprus, they shall still have no rest and no rejoicing. Okay, verse 13 talks about, "Behold the land of the Chaldeans." The Chaldeans, that's Babylon, just so you know. And it says, "This people was not till the Assyrian founded it for them that dwell in the wilderness." That talks about the Babylonians were once wild and barbarous peoples with no government until they became part of Assyria. And they would be under Assyria for some time until they rose to be a great power on their own and overthrew Assyria. And eventually became the great world power. until they fell to the Medians and the Persians. Okay, that's prophecy 1648, where it identifies that Tyre will fall to the Babylonians. Prophecy 1649, verses 14 and 15. Howl, ye ships of Tarshish, for your strength is laid waste. And it shall come to pass on that day that Tyre shall be forgotten 70 years, according to the days of one king. And after the end of 70 years shall Tyre sing as a harlot. So it's going to be destroyed. It's going to be barren for 70 years. Tyre will just simply lay in ruin for 70 years. This most likely, this 70 years most likely refers to the time that the Israelis were in Babylonian captivity. And at the end of the 70 years, Tyre shall be rebuilt. Tyre shall sing as a harlot. You know that, for Isaiah to write sings as a harlot, could this be a foreshadowing of the great prostitute that's found in the book of Revelation? That's certainly possible. I can't say for sure, but it seems very likely, as many prophecies in Isaiah do point to Revelation. All right. And then verse 17, it says, and it shall come to pass after the end of 70 years that the Lord shall visit Tyre, and she shall turn to her hire, and shall commit fornication with all the kingdoms of the world upon the face of the earth. Thus the reason why it says she will sing as a harlot, because she's going to commit fornication with all the nations. It is a worldly city underneath the world system, which is, of course, run by Satan. And Tyre would eventually fall again a few centuries later to Alexander the Great. So God gave Tyre a chance to get right with him, and it did not. It continued on its wicked ways, and again it fell. That's prophecy 1650, and then in verse 18, prophecy 1651, it says, and her merchandise and her hire shall be holiness to the Lord. It shall not be treasured nor laid up, for her merchandise shall be for them that dwell before the Lord to eat sufficiently and for durable clothing. So this, I believe, points to Tyre in the millennium. Apparently a Tyre will be in existence come the millennium, and this time it'll be a city that that is under God and will serve God. So verses 1 through 17 have already come to pass. Verse 18 has not yet come to pass. Chapter 24. This is a chapter dedicated to the Great Tribulation and the Millennial Kingdom. Prophecy 1652, verses 1 through 12. These verses just simply describe all the suffering and all the misery that will be apparent during the Great Tribulation. Then go to verses 13, 14, and 15, prophecy 1653. These verses describe the Jewish remnant, the remnant that will survive the siege of the Antichrist. And it says in verse 14, they shall lift up their voice, they shall sing for the majesty of the Lord, they shall cry aloud for the sea. So this is a remnant that is going to be rejoicing and will be completely for God and completely against the Antichrist. They'll be singing and rejoicing. As far as will they be singing and rejoicing before Christ returns, I don't know. All it says is that they'll be singing and rejoicing. Okay. Then prophecy 16:54 says, starting in verse 16, it says, the treacherous dealers have dealt treacherously. Yeah, the treacherous dealers have dealt very treacherously. Fear and the pit and the snare upon thee, O inhabitant of the earth, and it shall come to pass that he who fleeth from the noise of the fear shall fall into the pit, and then he that cometh out of the midst of the pit shall be taken in the snare. So there are going to be traps set up for those who try to flee. Isaiah is pretty much saying there's going to be no escape. There's definitely going to be no escape from the wrath of God when it comes. I believe that's what it's talking about. Then we skip down to verses 21 and 22. Prophecy 16:55 says, and it shall come to pass in that day that the Lord shall punish the host of the high ones that are on high, and the kings of the earth upon the earth. Now notice here that Isaiah makes two distinctions here. He says, he shall punish the host of the high ones, and the kings. I believe this refers to Satan. He is the host of the hosts. And kings of the earth, the Antichrist, he is a ruler on earth. So this is definitely a prophecy pointing to the fall of Satan and the Antichrist. And I suppose you could include the false prophet there as well. He is a religious ruler, a religious king. And verse 22, and they shall be gathered together as prisoners are gathered in the pit, and shall be shut up in the prison, and after many days they shall be visited. So, and it's then in Revelation it says, Satan shall be thrown into the abyss and locked up for 1,000 years. And the Antichrist and the false prophet, they shall be thrown alive into the lake of fire. So this is what, that's what these two verses are referring to. Again, prophecy 16:55. And then in verse 23, prophecy 16:56, then the moon shall be confounded and the sun ashamed. When the Lord of hosts shall reign in Mount Zion and in Jerusalem and before his ancients gloriously. So, this again is a prophecy about Jesus establishing the millennial kingdom. He shall reign in Mount Zion and in Jerusalem. Again, that's where all the action is going to take place come the second coming of Christ. Chapter 25. Go to verses 2 and 3. It says, for thou hast made of a city a heap, a defended city ruin, a palace of strangers to be no city. It shall never be built. Therefore shall the strong people glorify thee. The city of the terrible nations shall fear thee. This prophecy refers to the fall of Babylon in the end times. Yes. Okay. Then we skip down to verse 5. It says, thou shalt bring down the noise of strangers as the heat in a dry place, even the heat with the shadow of a cloud. The branch of the terrible ones shall be brought low. This is talking about God bring down the end time armies in the Battle of Armageddon. Yes, there's a lot of metaphors here. It says, thou shalt bring down the noise of the strangers. Any voices of triumph and victory the enemies of God will have, he's going to bring them down. As heat in a dry place, even heat with the shadow of a cloud, the branch of the terrible ones shall be brought low. Branches are high in the trees. God is going to tear the branches down. verse 6, Prophecy 16:59. And in this mountain shall the Lord of hosts make unto all people a feast of fat things, a feast of wine on the lees, of fat things full of marrow, of wines on the lees well refined. Now, you'll notice in the first part of the verse, in this mountain, I believe this ties in with chapter 24, verse 23, where it says, the Lord of hosts shall reign on Mount Zion. I believe that is the mountain. And there's all this talk about a feast of fat things and wines. In the book of Revelation, chapter 19, there is a marriage supper of the Lamb that's spoken of. Could this be the marriage supper of the Lamb that is described that is described in Revelation 19? It certainly sounds like it. I'm not entirely certain that it is. Some say the marriage supper takes place in heaven. This is talking about a feast on the mountain. So I really don't know. But it seems pretty likely. Then we go to verses 7 and 8. And he will destroy in this mountain the face of the covering cast over all people and the veil that is spread over all nations. He will swallow up death in victory, and the Lord God will wipe away tears off of all faces, and rebuke of his people shall he take away off all the earth, for the Lord has spoken it. In verse 7, this is Prophecy 16:60, talks about the face covering cast over all people, grief and misery. He's going to get away with that. He's going to do away with that. Verse 8, he shall swallow up death in victory. And in Revelations, death shall be thrown into the lake of fire. In fact, death was defeated when Christ was resurrected after 3 days. So in one way, swallowing up death and victory, in one way it already has happened, and in another sense, it's something that will happen. And the Lord will wipe away tears off of all the faces. That's something that is also mentioned in the book of Revelation. He shall wipe away every tear. And also says, rebuke of his people shall he take away off of all earth. That's talking about the removal of reproach, contempt, shame, and defeat. All that will be taken off his people. Okay, verse 9, Prophecy 16:61, and it shall be said in that day, lo, this is our God, we have waited for him. So, this is a waiting. It says, we have waited for him. I believe that refers to the second coming of Christ. And we are told to be ready. We are told to wait upon him. As was the case illustrated by the... the 10 virgins. They were... they had enough foresight to prepare their oils with extra oil because it was quite possible they'd be waiting for a very long time. And it turns out they did because they needed the extra oil and the five foolish virgins ran out. So this waiting on him, it talks about those who will be waiting for a second coming. And that is all the time we have for today. Thank you for joining us. We shall finish chapter 25 in next episode. Thank you.
Amen.